Okay, great. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks, Tim, and thanks, Jennifer, for inviting me to the world's epicenter of thinking about complex systems. Pretty intimidating. So I thought I'll share a few ideas and questions that I have about resilience of complex systems. So there's many complex systems, the climate, our brain, society. Is there anything general we can say about how resilient they are? So resilience is, where is my little man walking there? Was it walking, the little man?
Maybe he's in the bathroom.
No. What happened to my little man? I see it on my screen. Yeah, but, was the man walking? Yeah.
He was carrying a ball.
I think we have a technical... where is our technical... The slides are not moving. They're moving on my computer, but not on the screen. But you have seen the little...
Yes, it was there.
Let me unplug it and plug it back.
See what happens.
That's resilience. When you run into a problem...
There you go.
Hey, okay. So that's resilience, right? This little movie reminded me of the movie I saw on the airplane, which was Tomb Raider 2018 with Lara Croft. And she gets hit and she's down and she gets wounded. And each time you think it's the end, but she always bounces back. Oh, there it goes. Yeah, you see, you get a disappointment. No problem. Just keep going. So everybody knows what resilience is, and you can even buy a resilience lift extreme cream. So it's a well-known thing. This cream will help if you have a problem with your skin. Something happens to the skin, it will help the skin bounce back. All right. So that's resilience. It's the capacity to bounce back. And that's something that's interesting for all kinds of complex systems, for your body, for an ecosystem, for society. So how do you measure that? How do you quantify that? One way, the capacity to bounce back, you can just look how quickly it bounces back. If it bounces back very quickly, apparently it was very resilient. And that has been called engineering resilience by Holling, Buzz Holling, a famous ecologist. And he didn't like engineers too much, so that's why he called this kind of engineering resilience. It's like a very simplistic way of looking at resilience. Because he was studying ecosystems, and I'm studying ecosystems. I'm a lake ecologist. And in ecosystems, you every once in a while, you see that instead of bouncing back after a hot or a dry year, the ecosystem actually doesn't bounce back. It just moves to a very different state. A forest turns into a savanna, and it stays a savanna. A lake, instead of being clear, becomes turbid, and it stays clear. So many times when things happen, it will bounce back, but sometimes it won't. It will just go to a very different state. This is an example from a marine system where for many years it was crowded with this little animal. And we were monitoring it, and we got bored because it was all the time the same, and then it changed. So that kind of things happen. And one possible explanation is the possibility that an ecosystem has alternative attractors, alternative stable states, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with that idea. It's a very old idea, very old idea. This is... This is Salvador Dalí, and he was very interested in the so-called catastrophe theory in those days, in the 60s. René Thom had written a book in France, Catastrophe Theory, and Dalí somehow felt there was something really deep in that. He invited René Thom and Prigogine and other mathematicians for discussions on that in Catalonia, in Spain, where he was. And it's kept with him all his life. And this is a very symbolic picture, because this is the last picture taken of Salvador Dalí. He felt his tipping point was coming, so to say, seriously. And he dressed up one more time to have his last picture taken. After that, he died. And in the back, you see his last painting. It's the last painting he ever made. And this painting has a graph from that theory of tipping points. I think he had a good intuition that this is really something really deep and universal. And in the 60s, it became very popular, this idea. And there wasn't the same ecologist Holling that talked about the engineering resilience said, well, this kind of systems really requires another way of thinking about the capacity to bounce back, because sometimes there is no bouncing back. So what about the speed of bouncing back is only one aspect. Here you see the same graph that Dalí made. See, even though he made it in the 60s, we were able to publish it again in 2001 in Nature. And it's interesting because this whole theory got quite out of fashion, because I think they were like overstretching and trying to apply it to everything. But then they didn't have really good empirical evidence, and there was a kind of a backlash to it, and people started disliking it. But now it's back. It came back mainly in the first place because of the work on ecosystems. I think most ecologists are now convinced that this phenomenon can happen in ecosystems. And this is a way of explaining the stability properties. You see this graph, that's the equilibrium state of the system as a function of the conditions, some kind of stress factor, if you want. And you see that for some conditions, you can have three alternative stable states. A stable one, an unstable, and a stable again. So that's like, this is stable. So intuitively, the ball rolls to the stable point, and this is stable. And this is also an equilibrium, but it's unstable. It's on the top of the hill. What is important, if the conditions change, suppose this is your state, the conditions change, you see that the state won't change too much. It remains more or less the same. But what happens is that the stability landscape around you changes. You, in the end, you're in a very small hole, and a small push could potentially push you to the other state. So this is the saddle node bifurcation, if you want, is the tipping point. And as you approach this bifurcation, in the end, you become fragile, because this little hole that you're in, you're very easily flipped out of it. So that's what Holling then emphasized, that it's really important to know the size of like this valley that you're in, because if the size becomes very small, then you're flipped out very easily. So that was a new way of looking at resilience. And you can imagine that even though it became mainly used for ecosystems, it applies to other complex systems. It applies, for instance, to health. And since the past years, I've been working quite a bit on health, on the resilience of humans, and on animal resilience, I thought I'd share some of those thoughts with you. So thinking of health, and I think the intuition of Salvador Dalí was that if you're young, then your healthy state is pretty resilient. And as you age, unavoidably, you become frail. Unavoidably, you end up in the situation that if you break a hip, it causes something else and another trouble, and it's the end of the story. Whereas if you're young, you break the hip, no problem. You'll bounce back very quickly. So aging for animals and humans is obviously one of the things that has a large effect on resilience, and I'll get back to that. So the main question that we've been working on over the past years is whether it is possible to actually quantify systemic resilience of a complex system. quantify it, like so Holling had the idea, resilience is the size of the basin of attraction. So it's basically the perturbation you can take and still recover from it without flipping to the other state. But that's one way of quantifying it, but you don't want to start pushing old people or climate systems to see if they flip. So can you quantify it without destroying it? So are there more subtle ways of finding out what the resilience of the system is? It's like asking the question, can I find out how brittle this face is without destroying it? So it's a kind of tricky question. But actually, there are some universal properties of dynamical systems, of a class of dynamical systems, that might be interesting to use for that. That again, those are known for a long time already in physics, in mathematics. There are many sides to it, but I'll just emphasize a simple one, and that is the so-called critical slowing down. So what is critical slowing down? It's about the return rate after a small perturbation. So if you're in a deep valley, you're resilient. You perturb it a little bit, you roll back quickly. If this valley is about to disappear, it becomes smaller, but it also becomes shallower. So the slope becomes less, which means that you roll back slower. So in mathematical terms, that's about the dominant eigenvalue of your Jacobian matrix going to zero before this bifurcation. So it's a kind of simple caricature case. But the question we had is, can we actually measure that perhaps in real systems? So if you have this graph of Dalí, if you're far from this dangerous point here and you perturb it, the prediction is that you recover quickly, and here that you recover slowly. So that might be an indirect way, that recovery rate, of actually knowing whether you're getting close to such a critical point. Now, an experiment like that is nice, but you cannot always do an experiment. You can't do an experiment on a climate system if you're interested in the stability of a monsoon system, of the thermohaline circulation. You can't just go and perturb it. Same for elderly people. You just can't come and start perturbing them to see how resilient they are. So are there other ways to do that? And yes, there are other ways. If you think of it, all complex systems are always perturbed. So your brain is always... I'm perturbing your brain now. And the Earth system is always perturbed by volcano eruptions. So we're always in a regime of perturbations. And if you think of the behavior of a system under such a regime, if it's very resilient, the response of the system may look like this. And the same system, if it loses resilience, will start behaving differently in response to this natural regime of perturbations. You see, the variance tends to be larger, but also the fluctuations are becoming slower. They get more memory. The state today looks more like the state yesterday. See, tomorrow, today is more correlated. You get more temporal also correlation. That's a memory thing that you measure. It measures the slowness of the system. So those are examples of things that you may see happening if you just study the small ups and downs in systems. So we recently termed this class of indicators Dior's, so after the perfume, but it's also dynamic indicators of resilience. So if I go to the doctor, I actually tried to this morning, but he didn't want to see me. But you go to the doctor, am I resilient? So, well, let me look your temperature, and there is all kinds of correlates of resilience. But we are now thinking, well, if you want to know the capacity of bouncing back, why don't you actually measure that? Kind of the micro bouncing back things, the micro recovery patterns in everyday life, do they tell you something? So if you're highly resilient versus low resilience, frail, I mentioned the fast recovery versus slow recovery, the patterns you can see of fluctuations. And there is something else if you think of complex systems in terms of networks. So for instance, our body is a network of all kinds of elements, and there's many complex systems, the financial markets, whatever, that you can formalize as networks. Then you can think of networks where all the elements can be resilient or non-resilient. And what you expect, if that is a network where the elements depend on each other, where your blood pressure or your brain function depends on your blood pressure and so forth, you also expect that the cross correlations between the ups and downs that you see in that network, that they will increase if that network becomes frail and gets an increasing risk of cascading collapse of the elements that all depend on each other. So those are ideas, mathematically based ideas of that this is just dreaming. Oh, what if we could measure this? Maybe there is a way of finding out the resilience from very fundamental principles. And because of that, in principle, it should apply to your brain, to your intestinal microbe ecosystem, to the climate, anywhere where we expect that perhaps there is a tipping point. So we started looking in data to see if we could find any evidence for that. And we found it in all kinds of quite different places. The first place we started to look at was the history of climate. So in climate history, you see every once in a while an abrupt climate change. And it happens to be that the world expert on tipping points and abrupt climate change is in this room, and it is Tim Lenton. Yes. Any questions, go to Tim. And we've been working a bit together on this. Well, maybe not the world expert, but you know much more than I about it. So suppose you look at the dynamics of the climate here, and this is a long time series, and this is 40 million years ago. And here we see the end of the greenhouse Earth. So the Earth was without ice caps for most of its history. And then 34 million years ago, the Earth got ice caps. It got a transient state with ice caps much earlier. But those are the ice caps we know. So could you see that coming? Could you see, suppose you didn't know this, and you're a climate scientist and you live 34 million years ago, and they would ask your advice. This is happening to the climate. What do you think will be next? Maybe you do kind of regression analysis or so, and say, well, it's getting, but this would be difficult to predict. But maybe if you would have measured critical slowing down, if you would have measured temporal correlation, you would have seen that something was building up in the Earth system. The fluctuations were becoming slower and slower. And one possible explanation for that is that the Earth was approaching a tipping point. So here is another one, the end of the ice age. Suppose you were a scientist then, that's not so long ago. So what would you say? Well, it's getting colder and colder, it's stable, it'll stay like this probably. No, this happens. How would you know? Well, maybe if you would have measured the slowness of the fluctuations in the Earth system, you would have seen that something was building up there. So you never know, of course, what is really causing this kind of patterns, but you can't do the experiment. Climate science is difficult. We have models, we have data, but it's difficult to bring it all together. So it's more convincing if you do an experiment in the lab. So we did an experiment with a living system, a system of cyanobacteria that we kept, and we can drive that system to a collapse by giving it more light. The cyanobacteria like light, but if it's too much, they burn. And if there are a lot of cyanobacteria, they protect each other. But then the first start to die, and the rest get more light, and in the end, the whole thing crashes. So this is a nice lab system that we have. And there we also looked at those recovery rates. And sure enough, we could see that close to the tipping point, you see this critical slowing down. And then shortly after, there was a beautiful work by Dai et al., showing this with yeast, also in a science article. So yes, you can show this in controlled systems, not just physical systems, but also living systems with tipping points. So other things that yes? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that can happen very well. That can because systems can slow down for many reasons. So for instance, one common reason in the climate is that the heat capacity of a system changes. So for instance, if you have a mixed layer in the ocean and it becomes a deeper mixed layer, then it becomes slower because if it's driven by like atmospheric temperatures, you'll see it responds slower. So that is a quite common thing, for instance, in the climate system. And so this is about rates in systems, and there are so many things that affect rates. So it's definitely not a proof that you're approaching a tipping point, but it's a flag. Oh, maybe something interesting is happening in the system here. So one thing we looked at, also, in terms of this slowing down, is tropical forest, because we know that forest can flip into a savanna state. That's a well-known case of a hysteresis and a tipping point. And you have nowadays beautiful data on forest. You have every 2 weeks or so, you can have a satellite image of the forest, and you can look how green the forest looks, and then you can look at the small fluctuations of greenness in the forest. Here we show that plausibly the slowness of those fluctuations indeed tell you something about the resilience of forests in different places. Something that took me by surprise is this one that appeared in PNES, where they showed that there was also evidence of critical slowing down before the collapse of Neolithic cultures. So Tim Kohler knows much more than I do about this, and we were exploring it a bit together now also. But in the Neolithic times, you got population growth. So this is the start of agriculture. Many places you saw populations settling, human populations growing, and I think almost inevitably also crashing. And it turns out that before those crashes, almost all those populations showed signs of becoming slower in recovering from small adverse conditions. So this was visible in all those time series, and I think it's one of the things that we would like to explore now a bit further, also the time series of the early inhabitants of this region, the Pueblo people, where you see actually a series of population increase and crash, and then further increase and crash, further increase, crash, and then it moved to the what's the new to the.
So the northern Pueblo and southwest was entirely depopulated, and much of the surviving population came down to this area.
Right. Yeah. So we got this series of collapses and. What is very interesting in those periods of growth of societies, you see also a growth of inequality. And then the collapse goes with violence, usually. So that's one of the topics that we're thinking about and working on now. And one of the big questions, of course, is those collapses, why did they happen? Did they happen because it was just a bad climate condition, because it was a series of dry years? Well, usually they happened at bad climate conditions, but maybe that wasn't the only reason. Maybe they had built up to a fragile state. So can I borrow the chair that you take the water off? So this is the simple example of that is of the tipping point. It's of course the tipping point of the chair. So there is a point where this chair gets close to the tipping point and it's in a fragile state, and now When a fly lands on it, that can be enough, and the chair is gone. So you can say, "Oh, we have to do something about those flies in the building because they're tipping over chairs all the time." So you can say, "Well, thinking about something bigger than a fly, maybe a dry year. But maybe that dry year only did in that population because it had become fragile. So is there a way we can find that out? Well, so we're thinking to look a bit further into the micro fluctuations there and see if we can see these indicators of reduced resilience. Because that's like also with the climate case where we showed this critical slowing down before the collapse, it's an indirect evidence that maybe those turnovers have to do with tipping points, with a loss of resilience as the system becomes frail close to a tipping point. Another example of an application that took us a bit by surprise is in psychiatry. We had a workshop with a psychiatrist and a psychologist that wanted to see if we could do something together. And we explained all this theory, and they said, oh, we have time series of fluctuations in mood of humans and follow-up data. And sure enough, it turned out that people that had slowness in the mood fluctuations in recovery from small bad mood situations, they have a larger probability later in life to fall into a clinical depression. And depressed patients, when they start slowing down in their fluctuations, they apparently are closer to the tipping point of recovery. So that has kicked off a whole line of work that we're doing now in psychiatry, not only with depression, but also with other things like anxiety disorders and so forth. So I think Dali was right. There is something pretty cool here. There is some deep universality that's pretty crazy, because it's between the human mood and societies or the climate. You wouldn't expect that there are universal principles. Mostly they're very different, but in some aspects, some interesting aspects, maybe they're not so different altogether. So if you think of practical implications of this, one thing that we've been thinking about is how can you manage resilience? So what is important is that in complex systems, it's always a whole set of factors that affect your resilience. In us, it's age, but it's also lifestyle and adverse events in your life. In an ecosystem, it's the climate, but it's also nutrient loading. It's always multifactorial. So if you think of a stressor, and maybe there is a critical level where either there is a gradual decrease of the state or or there is some tipping point. But it will usually be the case that this critical level depends on other stressors. So for instance, we're studying lakes, and we know that if we put too much phosphorus in lakes, they can flip into a state dominated by cyanobacteria that can be toxic. And so if you want to avoid that, you need to stay below this phosphorus level. But cyanobacteria love hot weather. So if it becomes warm, you have a higher tendency for cyanobacterial problems. So if you want to stay safe, you need to go way down with your phosphorus level to stay under this boundary. And that's a story that repeats over and over. If a tropical forest, you can open the canopy, selectively harvesting trees, and it's all right. But if it's becoming dry, then the forest is at risk of burning and crashing. And the critical harvest level needs to be way lower to still be safe. So if you're interested in that, there is a little policy forum here that explains how that works for coral reefs, for tropical forests, and for wetlands as examples. And the idea, I think the main idea why we like putting it forward that way is that it gives you a possibility to do something. Because even if you can't do, as a local lake manager, too much about climate change, you can manage phosphorus and the water level. So there's always things you can do locally that are feasible, and you can do something about it. Of course, if you think about frailty and aging, you can't do anything about the ticking clocks. And you cannot do too much about the genes. But you can do something about your lifestyle and other things. It's always a multifactorial thing. So you can say, why? Well, this is it's a complex system, and then it's affected by so many factors. So what can we do if we don't understand everything? Well, no problem. Even if you only work on exercising, it's already good. See, that's the good news in a way. So since it's multifactorial, it can be disappointing, but you can also, well, that's good. Then there is maybe one thing that I can work on. So I like that. I like complex system science and thinking about it, but I also like it if you can try to make it useful in a way. So so let's think a little bit about that, about the body then as a complex system. It's of course you can think of it as a network. And you can think of it as a network where we have organs, the brain, the heart, the muscles, the kidney, and so forth, that work together to keep temperature, mood, blood pressure, posture within critical boundaries. So it's a network of complex systems that work together. They evolve to work together. Now, some of those subsystems can have tipping points themselves. I already talked about mood, and another one that's obvious is posture. Like you stand and you don't fall, and that's not a simple thing. You don't fall because you're constantly correcting, and your ability to do that depends on your muscles and your nervous system to continuously correct that. And if it doesn't work well, you tip over. So one way, for instance, we go about measuring that, because then we're interested in measuring the resilience of the subsystems and of the system as a whole. So for instance, posture, we put people on a balance plate with four pressure sensors, and we measure very high frequency the pressure on the different sensors. And you put a young person there, you see it goes, there's very quick, small corrections. You put an old person there, and you see it's going, you get sway. That system is showing the signs of critical slowing down. It's just less under control. I already showed it for mood. Blood pressure is another one. If you suddenly stand up, or you put people on a bed, and you flip the bed, and you measure the blood pressure, you get this barometric response. You lose the blood pressure, and quickly it goes back. If it goes back more slowly, that system of measuring and correcting is not working as well. And it is an indicator of resilience of that subsystem. But what is interesting is that the resilience we find of all those subsystems is also correlated. And as resilience of the whole thing erodes, you see it in most of the subsystems. For instance, we are working with Irish researchers that follow a cohort, a very large cohort of Irish women. And in this cohort, I think amazing large percentage, 13%, has been sexually abused as a young girl. And you see in the blood pressure response, you see this very clearly, you pick it up very clearly. Those women at the same age are less resilient than the ones that are not abused. And it has to do with stressors that have happened. And I can mention many more examples, but so this is a complex system that tends to go up or down altogether. And it's interesting to also to think about, of course, what you can do about resilience, because one interesting thing is that living systems like humans, they become more resilient if they're challenged. But there is a limit to that. But if you're challenged, you do a bit of not eating some days, running, all kind of challenging makes you more resilient. But don't overdo it. Yesterday, somebody told if it doesn't kill you, it makes you stronger. That's not entirely true, because like if you have too heavy events, it actually undermines the resilience. But now we're working also on animal research on that idea of adaptive resilience. So I'm fascinated by the body, and not only of the humans. We have an animal research groups in Wageningen that are very active. At the moment, we're rethinking the animal production system. We're not allowed to use as many antibiotics as we were before. And that gives a crisis in the animal production system, because it turns out most of those animals can only be kept alive by continuously giving them antibiotics. And if you're not allowed to do that, they just die. So we need to rethink animal resilience. And just one example of how multifactorial that is, we had an experiment with piglets. And those piglets, you can raise them in two ways. One is in a clean, traditional way, which is concrete, everything sterile, and they're there. And they grow up all right, gets lots of food. And the other is that they can run around, play in the dirt, have to search for their food. That's obviously less stressful for the piglet. And then what we cannot do in humans, but we can do in piglets, is let's see how resilient they are. So we challenge them with an injection of viruses and see what happens. And you see then that the piglets that were raised in this stressful environment, they basically all died, and the others mostly recovered. And there is more and more work showing how we are always facing a trade-off in our resilience. And if you have social stress, loneliness is in monkeys that they have studied the effect of loneliness on the immune system. Put your immune system on a different level, and the expert on this is Rob de Boer, also sitting here. Any questions about the immune system, go to Rob de Boer. So I find this wildly interesting, and also we had this workshop with people studying cows and piglets, honeybees. Let me quickly tell you the honeybee story, the pollinator crisis, right? So bees are dying. Why are bees dying? Well, we have those neonicotinoids, very different neonicotinoids, that are very bad for them, that they protect the crops. But that's not the only thing. If you look at what they're dying of, they're usually dying of a parasite or some disease. Why? Well, they don't have enough energy. Why? Because there's actually not many flowers, so they have to fly further. And they can't find the flowers very well because they're druggy because of the neonicotinoids. So it's like it's always this multifactorial thing. And if you want to understand resilience of any of those complex systems, you have to think about the different elements and how they work together. I wanted to quickly go to a slightly bigger question, the question of whether we can also think along those terms about a safe operating space for humanity on the globe. So as you know, we live in very interesting times. This is just 100,000 years. You see the climate has been fluctuating a lot until like this last period that we call the Holocene, in which it was very constant, and where we see the beginning of agriculture and the famous civilizations emerge. Humans flourished well. They were on the planet for a long time, but they really developed very well during this like 10,000 plus years of constant climate. So we'd like to keep that this way, and it's not obvious that it would stay this way. So this is coming out in PNES now very soon. This is the history of the Earth. This is the sea level, this is the temperature. We went through glacial cycles of about 100,000 years over and over again. So you see the temperature drops, then the sea level drops because all the water is locked up in ice caps. Then the temperature rises and the sea level rises. And we were actually scheduled for the next ice age about a century ago, but it didn't happen. And why didn't it happen? We're not exactly sure, but most likely because we emitted greenhouse gases. So without knowing it, this saved us likely of a next ice age, which is great because it's not nice to be in an ice age. But now we have a next problem because it's not obvious that we'll stay in this Holocene. It's quite likely that we would move to an Earth-free, ice-free Earth with very much higher sea levels, completely different Earth. And we don't like that. We want to stay close to where we are. We want to stay on this governed Earth. And there is like a bifurcation in the road around 2 degrees that we better do something if we want to stay in that governed Earth. And if you think about it, we're really in an unstable situation. We used to go about those glaciations, and now we are rolling into the hothouse. And we want to change the stability landscape of this complex system. We want to change it by adding feedbacks, by measuring what's going on, and making sure we stay in this climate. That's quite a challenge. We can, in principle, do it. And this is what Tim Lenton calls, I think, the Gaia 2.0. Right, the Gaia, keeping the Earth in a particular benign condition for us, now requires us to become aware of what is happening and taking control. And you're having a paper probably coming out with Bruno Latour on this.
One of them is coming out, and the other one.
Yeah. So that's interesting to think about it. So if you ask the economists, they had this special issue, Welcome to the Anthropocene, where they wrote in their editorial, humans have changed the way the world works. Now they have to change the way they think about it too. And that's not so easy. To see things differently is not easy. If you think them one way, it's difficult to see them another way. And you would say if you have many people in the room, one will see it the other way, and then tell the others and they'll see it the other way too. But that's not the way it works, because the way you see things, your worldview, that's very contagious. So we all tend to lock into the majority worldview. So even if there is something building up, we stay passive about it until we reach this tipping point that you say, well, I think something is happening. Oh yeah, my mother said so too. And then you get this amplification of change in worldview through social contagion. But it means that it takes a long time to respond in general for society. So if you're interested in that, there is this this work we did asking the question, what does it take for the public attitude on something to change? When does it change? So if you think about the future, what does it take to move to a situation where we're all worshipping the vegetables, happily eating vegetables? And if you want to eat a hamburger, you're alone in the corner of the table, sadly, and nobody wants to see you. Well, this has not happened on a large scale, although it happens in small groups, of course. But there are other things that have happened on a large scale. So we were, in this analysis, thinking about, so when did actually large turnovers of opinion happen? And so one example we looked at was foot binding in ancient China, where the feet of the little girls were wrapped so that they would never become very big. And that was thought to be beautiful, and that was thought to be a requirement to find a husband later in life. So as a mother, you wouldn't want not to do that, because then your girl would never find a husband. So this was like, this is a social trap, that society was in that trap for a long time. Some emperors tried to forbid it, but no mother wants to do it, because then my girl never finds a husband. And in the end, exposed to other ways of looking at it, and finally fueled by a women's movement, in the end, it ended. We have another example that we looked a bit more closely at, public smoking in public places. In Holland, we tried to forbid it many times, and it didn't work. It wasn't enforced. And suddenly it did work, and nobody is smoking in public places. And it became contagious between countries. It went to Italy, to France, so flip, flip, flop, everything flipped, and now you don't see it anymore. So the conclusion we had from analyzing those and other cases is that this kind of change can happen, but it can only happen when society is in a way ready for it. And it's hard to see whether it's ready for it. It sometimes looks like all the things we're saying as scientists or governments trying to make people behave differently are to deaf ears. You don't see any change. But maybe there is change. You just don't see it. The thing is becoming slowly, it's becoming unstable. And maybe then is the moment when a change can happen. So I leave it here. I just think that I find it pretty amazing that you can think about these very different systems in this way, that there are some universalities. Of course, it's very very difficult to actually measure it. It's not easy, and often you won't see them. But I see that as the glass half full, half empty, right? So you can concentrate on how much emptiness there is in the glass, but I rather say, well, it's pretty cool that across those very different systems, there are actually some things that seem to be universal. And if we find out better how it works, we may be able to measure, to quantify those things and make use of them in a practical way. So that's it. Thank you.
So Martin, a good question. Most of the work on tipping points is based on a closed system kind of approach and deterministic. So and yet, I mean, most of the examples you use are from systems that are not deterministic and that are not closed, subjected to stochasticity. And if we go to the stochastic version of this theory, there are some times where you can tell that the system will flip with a probability 1 in an infinite time if you just have a kind of a longevity equation.
So sure, yeah.
You might not need a driver at all.
Yeah.
So it's something that's going to happen. So the question goes on how you incorporate this kind of a more stochastic view to this.
Sure, yeah. Yeah, that's a very good point. If you, in a way, our thinking about dynamical systems has been dominated by thinking about equilibria, which is, of course, it's wrong. There are no equilibria. We're always in a stochastic environment, but it's more difficult to do the mathematics, including the stochasticity. So one approach is to take this Langevin approach and say, well, if we do it well, we can separate the deterministic part from the stochastic part. I actually think that's also a bit a schematization because it's a bit artificial in the end, but it's very important to work along those lines. And we have a large European project with mathematicians that is all about non-autonomous dynamical systems. So it's doing this work on systems in a stochastic environment. So this is a good moment to start the second part of my talk. I was expecting to I gave you a mezcal yesterday today. No, but it's good to say just a tiny little bit about this. So this thinking about this fluctuation close to equilibrium, it doesn't work if you have systems that are more wildly stochastic. And actually, then what you may see is that the system starts flipping between different states. And as you can think of this basin of attraction, and even if you have just a little bit of noise on it, in time infinity, you will move out. Say it. The question then becomes, for instance, can I define resilience in terms of the mean exit time from the basin of attraction? So, and we're working on that now a lot. One thing that is interesting, that if you have enough data, then you can actually characterize those basins of attraction from the fluctuation. And Tim Lenton with Valérie Livina has thought of that in a very nice way. They published this paper in the Climate of the Past showing that over the history of the ocean circulation, you can actually, from the data, infer alternative attractors. And something that now I have to introduce Milena Holmgren, with whom I worked on forests. We have been working on the question of, can we also do that if we don't have a very long time series, by just looking in many places in space, so replacing space for time. And that way we looked at the flips between savanna and forest. So very simple. You plot, this is rainfall, it fell off, and this is tree cover of the whole Earth, seen from the sky. So you see that if there is a lot of rain, you have a lot of tree cover. And if there is almost no rain, there is almost no trees. And in between, there is this cloud of points, which is the savanna. And if you, from this this data point, you can directly plot the stability landscapes if you make some assumptions. And that suggests that as precipitation increases, there are those alternative basins of attraction for savanna and rainforest and a treeless state. So that's one way to go about it. So then basically, this is whole story about a critical slowing down, indicators of resilience. And this is another approach, reconstructing basins of attraction, try to say something about the dynamics of the system together with those more deterministic stability properties, if you want. Of course, you cannot really separate it, because what is noise? There can also be noise in the system. It can be a chaotic system, intrinsically chaotic system, which is also affected by noise. So it's always this blend that you see in nature. And we try to make sense of it by separating noise from the deterministic part and so. But it's always kind of, it's all we can do. We try to separate those things, but we're looking at a mess, of course. We're trying to make sense of it. Okay, yeah. Thanks for a nice question. No, but it's an obvious question, so that's why I had those slides here. Yeah. Other.
Yeah. I was wondering, it seems that there might be some systems that are more likely to express these slowing down periods in other dynamical systems, like, no, that's not going to happen. Is there any way you can classify these different systems, like, oh, this is where I expect it, this is where I don't expect it?
Well, this is one of those things where you say when it's very wildly stochastic, you'll never be close to an equilibrium, so you'll never see slowing down. Another obvious one is when the system itself is very slow altogether, and you're forcing it. So if I showed the examples of the climate, and then you may think, oh, now it's interesting. Let's look at the climate system now. Are we approaching a tipping point? And with Tim, we've been looking at that, but it's actually for some systems you can do that, but for the slower systems such as ocean circulation and ice caps, they're so slow that you cannot expect to pick up this signal. So we're changing, the forcing of the system is very fast, and the system may have passed a tipping point, but you don't see it. It's hanging in the air, and it's free falling, but very slowly. So In the cases where the intrinsic dynamics of the system are very slow, then you can also not expect to see critical slowing down. Tim, Milena?
Yeah. I think the answer there is lots of these systems are on the face of it very high dimensional, and it becomes a question about whether you can legitimately reduce the dimensionality of the system down, in this case, to what the mathematicians would call co-dimension one. If you can't, then you're not going to see a simple fold bifurcation, but if you can reduce it down to a two-dimensional system, you might see the possibility to go through a bifurcation to an oscillation and so on. And we have loads of toolkits, right, for dimensionality reduction. So when presented with a really complex system, we can use that toolkit to see whether statistically we believe the dimensionality passes down or it doesn't. There's quite a lot of subtlety in that, because the mass says specifically around these points that it
there's an established theory that even higher dimensional systems can behave like lower dimensional systems true bifurcation points. So it's a bit subtle, but I would say that
maybe one interesting thing that was for myself an eye-opener when we wrote this article about critical slowing down in the mood system before depression. The reviewers of that paper, we had made a little model in there of four mood dimensions that the psychologists told us are important mood dimensions. It's sad, anxious, happy and content. And the psychologists think that those are like complementary dimensions that are important. So we made a little model with a network model, and we showed that you can expect this critical slowing down and so. But then the referee said, but what are you really modeling? What are the units? Is it grams per meter square, or what is it really? And so, I don't really know. And then we talked again to the psychiatrist and the psychologist, and they said, well, the way we see it is that those mood dimensions have evolved for us to probe a very complex dynamical system and summarize it in a way that helps you direct your behavior. And then we thought, okay, let's make a very complex network with tipping points. And then we do we expose it to noise, and then we do a principal component analysis. We make four principal components of that system, and then we look whether in the principal components we see this critical slowing down. And sure enough, you see it. So it's quite independent of all the complexity underneath. Yeah. Milena.
Increasing in autocorrelation is a generic early indicator that something may drastically change. But if you were a manager of a system, you want to know how close you are of actually changing. So because it's not the same if that change is going to happen in 100 years from now, or in 10, or in 1, or in the next month. So I was wondering if you have explored if it's possible to study the behavior of the early warning indicator itself. So I'm not a mathematician, but I wonder if you could example say something if the slope of the increase in the autocorrelation or if the length of the time series or something. The mathematical behavior of the early warning indicator itself that could be generic, because I think that would
have
been so powerful for
in principle, so at the saddle node bifurcation point, in principle, the temporal correlation goes to one. It freezes, it becomes very slow. The problem is, it will never happen in reality, because way before you're there, you already moved to the other state.
Hello.
Hey.
We have this room booked 2:15.
That's now. Okay. Yeah. I'll wrap it quickly. Yeah.
1:15.
It's now 1:15. Oh, you meant it? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, so we moved away, to make it a long story short, from early warning signals also because of that, and now call it indicators of resilience. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's always some fly sitting on your chair that does it. You never know whether it will be a fly or a big bird or something else. You can never really predict.
Yeah.